How's it going, legends? You guys have been asking about this car, so welcome back to another video on the RX-7. In this video, we are going to address the lack of boost control in this setup. It's turned an otherwise very balanced, a very direct car to drive into a bit of a monster. So in the last video, we were out at Sydney Motorsport Park doing a shakedown on this new engine package, and it just performed flawlessly, but it was hard to control. When I bought the car a couple years ago, it came with this Rotormaster turbo kit. So it's a precision 64-66 turbo with a 45mm wastegate and some sort of mild steel manifold. So definitely not ideal for boost control, and running on just gate pressure, so it's an 8-pound spring, we were getting boost spikes up to about 18 pounds and triggering Haltech's boost cut. Current setup as is not suitable for what we're trying to do. It's made the car untrackable, especially in the low to mid speed corners. This has not been a problem until now. So even with the old street port 13B, we never saw the same boost creep as what we've been seeing. So you might be wondering why, and that's because this is now a bridge ported 13B. Now with any porting, you're gonna get an increase in exhaust gas flow. And flowing that exhaust gas through a manifold, which is kind of poorly designed with a wastegate in a position where it's ineffective for controlling boost, this setup is doing absolutely nothing for boost control. The only boost control is my foot, and it's not doing a very good job. So we have nowhere to go about it. We have to upgrade a few components. So in this video, we are going to be upgrading this to a brand new stainless steel ARTEC manifold, and also a TurboSmart 60mm wastegate. And the exciting thing is we're heading back to the dyno at race only for a retune as well. So keen to see how well we can control the boost. I would love to have the boost control down to about 8 pounds of boost, and then be able to control it by boost by gear. And yeah, maybe we might also make a bit more power. So who knows? I'm pretty excited. So let's get into it. We're gonna take out what's currently there and take it over to the bench. And I wanna show you all our new parts. All right, back on the stands. And these cars are just so easy to work on, especially with this single turbo setup. So being the 64-66, it's oil lubricated, oil cooled. So no water lines here. Pretty straightforward, eh? Just the oil lines off. So we've got the feed and the drain. We'll just undo those, undo that V-band. Couple of nuts on the manifold, and this whole setup should come straight out. Pretty straightforward, let's get into it. Oh, you're kidding. All right, I've gone and put this back together just to give you guys a bit of an understanding of how this works and perhaps maybe why we are getting these boost control issues. So this is the wastegate, this is the turbo, and we've got the manifold here, which holds the system together. So essentially, I believe my issue is because of the wastegate's ability to bypass exhaust gas from the turbine wheel. So when we're hitting the higher RPMs, it's just not flowing enough air out of the wastegate, and then in turn just keeps spinning the turbine wheel and building too much boost. And to explain how this works, so this is a 45mm wastegate. It's got an 8-pound spring inside. And inside this wastegate, there's a diaphragm, and this is our boost pressure reference line. So this attaches to the lower port on the wastegate. This line runs to the MAC valve I've got installed. So it's just a 3-port boost solenoid. And the other end of that, the hose, will link up to the front cover on the turbo. So as the turbine wheel spins and builds boost pressure, we've got boost, positive pressure going through that lower port on the wastegate housing. And as that builds boost and reaches and exceeds that 8-pound spring pressure, that's when the diaphragm will lift up and allow the valve to open. And then it'll just, yeah, the exhaust gas will flow and ventilate out through the screamer pipe. And that in theory is how the wastegate is able to regulate the turbo speed and hopefully not exceed that spring pressure. I've just gone and propped this up so you can have a look at the wastegate position. Now, to be effective, the manifold really needs to be designed in a way which it directs exhaust gas to the wastegate for it to be bypassed out of the system. And really, this is an example where it hasn't been designed correctly, and TurboSmart actually have a really good graphic on this, but you can't see it too well, but at the merge there, the pipe actually angles out inside that way and then curves around to the wastegate. And the reason they've done this is for the packaging on the FD. It actually puts the wastegate in a position where it's really easy to access from under the car, but obviously not ideal for boost control. This gate position really does have more than a 90 degree bend and definitely not going to be efficient in bypassing exhaust gas. So I hypothesize as well, I was having a few hesitation, jerkiness at the track, especially in the low, probably low to medium speed, mid corner, partial throttle lift. What would happen is it kind of would like jerk, it kind of come off and then on boost. And I honestly think there is some sort of, maybe some sort of vacuum effect where the wastegate's being pulled shut because of the back pressure. Maybe I have a theory on this, but I don't really know if it makes sense. So if you wanna let me know in the comments what you think. Yeah, I really do think we're gonna be able to solve this issue. So to summarize that, here are our two problems. So number one, the wastegate is just size too small for the amount of exhaust gas that Bridgeport is flowing. Number two is just the poor manifold design, and a combination of the both is the reason why we're having these boost control issues. Now, don't get me wrong, I think a setup like this is probably gonna be okay in a high boost application, but for what I do, mainly circuit work and not really knowing rear-wheel drive setups too well at this stage, I really want something drivable. So this, I would love to have low boost at 8 pounds, all the way to 15, 16 pounds of boost within the limits of 98 fuel. So to fix our issues, it's time for an upgrade. All right, box number one. Now, if you've been following my socials, you would have seen this coming. So I've gone with Artec's new cast stainless steel manifold. So I've already unboxed this, but it's always nice opening it again. Got some Artec branded stuff here, and the packaging is just really nice. You know they mean business when the packaging is this nice. So what we have here is Artec's 13B cast stainless steel manifold, and I've gone with the T4 flange to match our 6466. This really is a piece of art, and they've done CFD testing on this so that we know the exhaust gas flow is efficient, and if you look inside, it is incredibly smooth. What's probably the coolest thing about this is they call it a split pulse design, where there is individual runner separation all the way from the flange through to the turbo and out all the way to the wastegate valve. Something which is extremely hard to do on some sort of fabricated unit. So yeah, I'm sure the task of casting one of these is also very complex. Also, being a cast manifold, it's packaged really well. It's very light and compact, as you can see, and it's cast in 347, which is a harder stainless steel and apparently corrosion resistant. So we know that this is very strong, and I think this is going to be a very efficient setup. Now, as is, it comes with a flange for a 50 millimeter turbo smart wastegate, and they've also provided you with a cut line over there if you decide to run a 60 millimeter wastegate, which is what we are gonna do. So box number two, now this is our next upgrade, and I've gone with the 60 millimeter Turbo Smart, which is the biggest in their lineup of their conventional gates. So yeah, it's a big unit, huge 60 millimeter valve, and yeah, it's also water cooled, which I don't think I'll be using. But yeah, this is really big compared to my 45 millimeter gate. Past few months, I've been back and forth with my tuner Omar, and I kind of wanted to try out the new E-gate from TurboSmart, but after some discussion, we've decided to stay with the conventional style and just see how it goes. And I really do think that this is going to be sufficient. Because we are running the 60 millimeter gate, we need to weld on a different flange to this cut line. So this is the flange here. It comes with a gate, and essentially we need to just cut this piece off and then weld this on. Now, because this is 347, I'm told it's a little bit harder to weld, and I'm not about to risk it on this beautiful piece of art. So my plan is just to mock fit it on the car, and then probably next week we'll take it down to my mate's workshop, Johnny from PL Fab, and I'll get him to weld on that flange for me. All right, let's get into it. Got the turbo and the manifold mounted, and I will quickly show you guys how it fits. So it's definitely pushed the turbo quite a fair way forwards. I'd say probably about 50 mil forwards. It shouldn't be a problem. And because the turbo is kind of in a similar position, I think we'll be able to reuse most of our piping. So just the charge piping here, this would sit somewhere like this. So we should be able to just shorten it there, and then run the bead roller on that. So that's gonna be a problem. Next thing is our air filter, the ProFlow. Just jam it in there. Yeah, she's sweet. I'm glad actually. I really didn't want to run a turbo guard, so just pop that off. The next thing I'm interested in is how the wastegate's gonna sit. So because the turbo's pushed so far forwards now, we have a lot more room at the back here for the wastegate. Hello. So I've got my gate here, and this is still the 50 mil flange on the manifold. So I'm just gonna have to hold it there, and it should sit just around there, like that. So we should still be able to get, yeah, easily 3.5 inch piping in there. Pulled it back off the car, and tomorrow we can get started on the fabrication side of things to get this manifold mated up to the 60 millimeter wastegate. So ARTEC provides you with a cut line here. You really can't stuff this up. And once we've cut that off, we can go and clean up the inside and make sure that our divider is nice and smooth. And then we can weld up the 60 millimeter wastegate flange. And well, I'm not gonna weld it up. I've just spoken to my mate Johnny at PL Fab. He's gonna sort it out for me. I'll see you guys there. All right, guys, I'm here with Johnny. I haven't seen him for a long time.
It's been a long time.
It has been a long time. Yeah, but it's good to be back, seeing him and checking out what he's doing. A couple of years ago, he was welding in the backyard.
Yes, that's correct.
That was a long time ago.
Back in, that would've been 10 years ago now, I think.
10 years?
I think so. 10 yeah. years.
We've and since then, years. We've both had kids.
Yes, we've done some very big mistakes.
Yeah, Johnny is the sole guy behind PL Fab. He does a lot of fab work with anything, really.
Yes.
What kind of things
everything,
do you do?
Right here. You will see an altered class drag car.
Yeah.
Which I'm just piecing together for another customer, mounting a whole bunch of things.
That's a big turbo. I think the last time I saw Johnny, we were at maybe at the drag strip.
Was that when I blew my motor?
And then you I think you dropped a valve.
Oh yes. Yeah, yeah. Yes, yes. And that it's was actually the guy I worked with was here that night.
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, the guy here was there that night, and that was a very catastrophic moment.
Yeah, that was bad, eh?
It was very bad.
Yeah.
It was very bad.
That was a fun night.
I got pictures of it somewhere, like at 8.
I'm pretty sure you pulled the plug off, and yes. We were looking inside, and the plug just like destroyed.
Demolished. there was nothing left of it.
But since then, you know, Johnny's come a long way. Yes. He's one of the only guys I know who can do like Mickey Mouse welds. Beautiful world.
No, there's a few in Sydney.
Yeah, he's being humble, and he's also been the guy kind of behind the scenes giving me critical advice on my welding, which is why I brought the manifold down today. I'm always amazed at how clear your welds are. It's all always got a bit of a goldness to it too.
The goldness is just heat control.
Yeah.
And letting the post flow.
Yeah.
Enough post flow.
You have a lot of post flow. How long is that? 5-6 seconds?
12.
12 seconds?
12 seconds.
Yeah, that's probably twice as much as me. Well, Johnny, you've done it again. Thank you so much.
Done it again. Feel good.
Always for your tips in it as well. Oh, look, it's beautiful, guys. Yeah, so if you guys need any fabrication work in Sydney, what part of Sydney is this?
Southwest.
Your boy Johnny can can weld. Thank you, Johnny.
All good, thank you.
All right, we're home. Wasted no time, got the gate on there. So this is the big 60 millimeter. And look at Johnny's welds. Immaculate. I can weld, but I can never get these colors. I always get like a blue, purple, bit of gray. And I definitely learned a lot tonight, that's for sure. So. Yeah, got a couple hours, so let's go and fit this manifold into the car. We can start planning out the downpipe. So you can see just how tight of a fit it's gonna be for that downpipe to travel down to our exhaust system. So that's a 60 mil gate. It is very big compared to the 50. I guess starting with the screamer pipe, we're just going to run a tight radius 90 down to the subframe. I'm thinking it probably will clear the firewall. Next thing we need to work out is our downpipe tubing. So I still want to keep the 3.5 inch tubing. I really think it does help with reducing back pressure and overall heat in the system. So this is a piece of 3.5 inch tubing from my old downpipe. So just squeezing it there between the gate and the firewall. That's the gate and that's the firewall. So there really is not much clearance at all. But I still really want to keep this 3.5 inch tubing. And you might be able to see as well, I have removed for now the firewall heat shield because it just was impeding on, there we go, the heat shield, because it was just sitting way too close. But I really do think I can make it work. So probably what I need to do is rotate and clock that, the air ports on the gate. I can clock that downwards, run our air lines along the side of the chassis rail. But yeah, so in the early stages of planning at the moment, and you know, this planning stuff always takes the most time. And once I have a good idea of what parts I need to order, we get them here, we do our cuts, I'll be able to give you guys the exact angles that we need to make a downpipe for specifically this setup with a 60 millimeter gate. So that'll save you guys a lot of time, because I know that this is going to be a very tight fit, and it's not going to be something just, you know, textbook downpipe. I reckon it's going to be probably a 30 degree bend and another 30 degree bend, and we might need to do a pie cut somewhere. I'm not entirely excited about this part of fabrication. So this next part of the video is gonna be a bit choppy, and then we'll go back to the bench and I can show you everything we need for this downpipe. So we come across our first little issue. So I was trying to mock fit the rehousing onto the manifold because I wanna check for the clearance of the stud. So I've just gone with these Inconel studs. And then I just couldn't get the rehousing to sit right. So I have checked for warpage and I think I've found a bit of an issue. So this is a straight edge ruler. Just putting it between the bolt holes, and that's completely flat. You can pretty much feel the edge on the ruler, and that's fine as well. That's fine as well like this. This is fine too. So then you look at the flange and you can see a bit of marking and scoring on the top here. So I put my ruler on top, and if I bring the camera down, you can even see light under the ruler, and you can see that play there. So this has come up. There is a hump here. And when you go back to the old manifold, you can also see the marking on this side. And if you run your finger across, I can feel a bit of a drop in that divider flange. So my theory is that because probably, you know, rotaries are they run really, really hot. I think that being unsupported, this is just warped downwards. And I think that the rehousing, you know, with the different, with all the heat cycles, it's probably just come down with it. So yeah, I don't think this is a big problem. I will probably get it machined flat and we can move on. All right, so this is just a bit of an off-cut 3.5 inch tube, and I've got my 30 degree bend from my old downpipe. And it's pretty tight, but it's gonna sit something like this. Sits really tight onto that bell housing on the back. And we've got enough clearance. Should be enough to put the OEM heat shield back on. Let's have a look from the bottom. All right. This is how it looks. So obviously I've had a play with it, and this is probably the tightest fitment I can get to the gate and what I'm comfortable with against the bell housing. So yeah, this will come up a little bit, maybe like a mil or two off the gate. But we should be able to get it sitting very close. And if I really need to, if I'm desperate, I could definitely just, probably notch out the gate a little bit just to give it maybe even a mil or two of clearance. And I've got to bridge it from this pipe all the way over to our new flange over here. So yeah, I've got another piece of pipe here. This is another 30 degree, I think. So let's just turn it around over here and see how well it's gonna sit. So yeah, that's way off at the moment. That is really far off. Obviously don't have the right piping at the moment, but if this sat over here, we are really far off. So what I think we'll need to do is we're gonna have to angle it somewhere. We're gonna have to add another bend, probably around here. So we are making a few adjustments so the wastegate will suit our setup. And I've already taken the top hat off with the locking collar to expose the spring. The way you do this is you clamp it down into a vise, remove that locking collar, and then just slowly wound back the vise. And then, just be careful you don't get the spring exploding in your face. But out of the box, it comes pre-installed with the 14 PSI spring. We really want to size up the spring to the minimum boost pressure you want to run on the system. So I've said that I want to run 8 pounds, and the kit includes a white 7 PSI spring. This is a purple 5 PSI spring, and also the raw, which is a 3 PSI. So what you do is you kind of just mix and match these springs to your desired gate pressure. So I'm just going to put in the 7 pound spring, 7 PSI is fine for me, and we can use the boost controller to add more boost. And because the spring is quite light, I'm probably just going to be able to compress it. There we go, and then we can put it back in the vise and tighten it down. So yeah, just be very careful you don't go and strip these threads. And the last thing we need to do as well is to clock the actuator on the gate, just so that we can get a bit more clearance with that downpipe. So there's another collar down here, which you can go ahead and loosen, and then we can just clock it how we want. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that. I'm not sure if you can see, but there is another smaller collar on the main body of the wastegate. So think about loosening that nut from this side, and bringing that nut down. So you're loosening anti-clockwise in that direction. There we go. And just back it off. And then this should be free. There we go. This afternoon we got back from Performance Exhaust Northmead, and Hack's a legend. He went and put this on his belt sander and flatten the surface on the flange of the rehousing. So just confirming that this is a common issue for the divider to warp, and apparently that's why on the HKS manifold, there's actually a relief cut there to allow that to warp out. So it's flat now, and otherwise I've also got the angles all worked out. It is a really hard job filming, so I don't have much content on what I did. As you can see, there's really not much room under there. Really need a hoist in here. Starting from the V-band on the rehousing, our first piece of tube is a straight piece, and you can see I've also done a bit of a cut. So that is a 3-4 degree angle I've done on the pipe. And just remembering how tight we are in terms of space, and this will set us up so that the angle of the pipe bring the downpipe closer to the engine and away from that firewall. So from that straight piece, we've got a 30 degree bend. Now this came off my old downpipe and I've just cleaned it up. And to be honest, by the time this has gone through a few heat cycles, it's gonna start rusting anyway. So stainless steel 304 is not rust free. From that 30, we are shooting down the firewall now. So we have another 30 degree bend here, a bit of a longer leg on both sides. Nothing special, and then now we have to start angling the exhaust and bring it a bit more level. So we've got a 10 degree angle, and this could have probably been my last angle. However, I made a big mistake and cut it too short, so I've went and reduced this pipe a bit more and then done another pie cut, and this way we can actually bring it a lot more level into that 2-bolt flange. So yeah, that's a lot of work I've done in the background. You know, cleaning this all up as well has taken a lot of time. So yeah, now I'm going to tack weld this together, and once I'm happy with the fitment on the RX-7, I can start welding this up for the last time. Now check out that fitment. We have plenty. It's close to the bell housing and it's tucked up right against the gate. So when I tighten this gate down and actually push it in about another 2 mil, gives a bit more. But yeah, this is a good fitment. All right, so here is my home purge setup. Got a double regulator on the cylinder, so this line goes into the rehousing. Just taped it up and got foil there blocking it up, and then a bit of foil up here with a couple of holes punched through. So yeah, gonna let that purge for a few minutes. And then, yeah, we'll be sweet. So last night, got a bit carried away, and then I'm welding up the whole downpipe. Got some nice colors going on here. Yeah, but with so many welds like this, you gotta let the material cool down before you keep going, and in some places it has gotten a bit hot, especially that one over there. But yeah, today's a public holiday. We've got a few things to do, and my plan is to get the car running today because I've booked in with Omar for the end of this week. So what's left to do? So we're gonna fit it up, weld on that flange, shorten the charge pipe, run our boost reference line, and that's it. So it's gonna be a long day. Let's get straight into it. All right, it has been a very, very long day. I think I've been in the garage for like 8 or 9 hours today, so yeah, doing okay. I've had a shower, I had my dinner, and I'm back. We need to get the car running by tomorrow. So yeah, this is everything we have on the bench, and I want to show you guys before we do the final fit. So ARTEC manifold with a larger flange for the 60 mil gate, and this all fits in the RX-7, the FD. And then from this, we've got a tight radius 90. This is a 2.5 inch tube. I've done another 5 degree cut on that tube just to get it angling a little bit more that way. And then once this is sitting in the car, we can mock fit the final part of the screamer and probably weld this on. So this is another 5 degree. I'm really trying to get the heat away from the car. So turbo, same turbo. We just need to clock the turbo tonight. When we get our new oil drain in there. I've decided to try out these flexible oil drains. We're coming off something like this. This is a dash 10 oil drain. The run is so short, you probably have two fittings and like a tiny bit of hose. So a bit pointless. Gonna try this product. I've never used these before. I've got the 150 here, which didn't fit when I mock fitted it, but this is a 200 mil that I pinched off my mate Zach. It was very handy to have that. New gaskets. I am going to a composite gasket. It's a lot cheaper. And we're trying the super seal one with the firing. Inconel studs for the manifold. And with Inconel, you know, these things are super hard. You can crank it right down and not have issues with threading. Yeah, so we'll install this once the manifold's in the car. It's just very tight near the steering rack. With these Inconel studs, we're going with the Stage 8 locking fasteners. Now, some people might think this is overkill, but I used this in my old B-Series build, and these were amazing. They're not cheap, but yeah, definitely, I never had a nut loose after that. Now, with the manifold nuts, so where the housing meets the manifold, I bought these, I don't know why I bought these, ARP, I think it's like a chromoly nut. However, I feel like the surface area is quite small compared to my factory nut. Well, I'm not sure if this is factory, but this came off the car and it's a serrated nut design. I think having the larger surface area outweighs the strength, the hardened strength of that chromoly nut. So we're just gonna keep these and also be using one of these Nord lock washers. The way these work is there are two locking washers on each other. It's not focusing very well. But you can see that there are kind of teeth inside the washers, and two of them together will lock that in place. So we're going to put that on the serrated nut, and I think this is probably the best solution. New gasket, new V-band, and yeah, check out these welds. I'm definitely getting better at the V-bands. That's a bit cold, But yeah, not too bad, not too bad. Okay, oh yeah, it's just a new boost line. I had one of these pop off at the track. It was a silicon hose, so we're just gonna go with, yeah, just a few speed flow fittings and some line. You'll need about a meter of that. And that's pretty much it. So everything has a procedure to go in because it's quite tight in there. We're gonna go with a manifold on first with a new gasket, and then we will fit our studs, and then we'll fit our turbo, and then we'll fit the downpipe, and then we'll fit the gate. Let's hope it goes in smoothly. So first goes on our gasket. So this is from an FC RX-7. You can see that there are these EGR ports. We don't need them in the setup. So this comes from the 13B FC. Next we have the ARTEC manifold. Now I'm going to show you how to get it in because it's a bit tight on the steering rack. So you drop it down below the bottom exhaust stud on the right. So this exhaust stud, you drop it below that, angle it down in line with the steering rack, and you want to pop that stud in first, and then you can just jiggle it a little bit, bring it forwards, and you can get the rest, and you can get the rest of the studs in. Our Nord lock washers on each stud. Next, we're installing the Inconel exhaust stud. Now, if you look closely, it's a bit of junk in the threads. For what you pay for these, you'd think they'd clean it up. The way you install these, pretty simple. Essentially, tighten two nuts onto each other. So we're gonna thread a bottom nut on like that. Then you thread a second nut on top. You tighten the nuts onto each other. And then you can use the top nut as the head of a bolt. Tight. I love this sound. Ooh. This is take number three. We've gone back to the 200 mil. I'll explain this later. So next we're going to be installing the stage 8 fastener. So you've got the nut here, it's just a standard stainless steel nut. You've got the locking ring and then the circlip for the ring. It's currently 11:30. I am close to calling it quits because it started to fight me, and usually at this point I just I sleep on it. But I was like, oh, I really wanted to get this on. What I've done here, I really did struggle to access the nut on the back side. So on the T4 flange, the upper right nut. The only way I could get that on, especially keeping the intake manifold still on there, was to loosen the manifold again and then drop the turbo back, and then you can access the nut in there. So she's tight now, she's not going anywhere. And yeah, let's tighten the rest of the nuts and then we can move on to the downpipe. Look at that fitment. That's awesome. That's honestly really good fitment. These are little welds. There's four dabs here, a bit too cold, but look at that fitment. I'm gonna sleep well tonight. All right, it's proper late now. We're gonna end tonight on a high. We're almost there actually. Only thing left to do is the screamer. But yeah, it was a good night, good day. Solid 12-hour session on the car, and yeah, tomorrow we should be able to get this sorted, and hopefully on the dyno end of the week. Let's see how we go. It's the next evening and we have a dyno date for tomorrow afternoon. Things are moving quickly, but I'm pretty much there, I think, and tonight we're just going to button everything up and tomorrow we can turnkey. So I've got the day off tomorrow, but the car needs to be ready by tonight. So let's pick up where we left it. Here it is. Here is our wastegate downpipe screamer pipe setup. You don't have to tell me. It's gonna be loud, I know. And look at the clearance between the wastegate and the downpipe. I've got something here to test the clearance. Free advertising for Artec. It is one Artec sticker clearance. I wish I had a bit more in it, but I think what I'll do is actually pull this locking ring down and clearance a bit if it starts to touch. But otherwise, yeah, it'll do for now.
Here is our shortened pipe and straight into the AliExpress tube bender. This thing has already paid for itself. It's done like five cars. So it looks like the one from Aeroflow, interestingly. Beautiful. We've already run the line and you can see off the back of the wastegate, there's a 90 degree fitting. It's a speed flow fitting. Line runs parallel to the chassis rail. And then there's a P clamp over there holding the line on, and then the line will wrap around with the other hose and come into our three port solenoid. This is the 90 degree fitting. Goes on the solenoid like this, and we just have to cut the line, insert an olive, and then tighten this down. Very straightforward. Little marking. Make sure you cut it square. So you insert the back end of the fitting and then you insert the olive. You'll see the Teflon tucked up inside that olive, and then you can just pull it down, insert the rest of your fitting. It's really easy. And I do like this the speed flow design. They always do seem a lot easier to make. There we have it. Just for aesthetic purposes, you just want to line up these two nuts. But yeah, that's our boost reference line. So I've run the boost lines. So number two on the three port goes to the bottom port on the wastegate. Number three port goes to the front cover on the turbo. And number one just vents the atmosphere. And guys, this car is ready to turnkey, and I will be doing that tomorrow. But there's just one last thing we're doing tonight, and it's something I've wanted to do for a while. I've been waiting for a video to come up to do this, and that is to upgrade all those old rusty pulleys on the engine. And I've actually had these for a little while now. More billety parts for the FD. For a long time, I've really wanted to go for a billet theme in here, and I haven't done a good job. But yeah, finally picked up this set. It's really hard to find a manufacturer who's still making parts for such an old engine. So thanks Emma for that. I've also got the oil cap because he didn't have billet at the time, and we can finally put that on. So gonna quickly get those on now. I can't wait to see how it looks. Check it out, guys. So shiny. Guys, look at that. It's cleaned up the engine bay so nicely. I realized I didn't pick up their belt, which I probably should get anyway, because it's a 5-ribbed belt compared to the 4-ribbed belt I have for the water pump. I'm gonna try to get one first thing in the morning, but if not, that's all right. I'll just put the stock pulley back on and I'll run the rest of them for now. So yeah, oh, it looks so good, guys. Anyways, I'm gonna get some rest. See you guys in the morning. All sorted. Finished it up this morning and then took it for a drive, gave it a wash, and she's purring. Just making all the right noises. Pulley's in, but I had to go back to the stock alternator pulley. I just couldn't find the right belt for this. I think Omar has something for me. So yeah, car's ready. Just one final check and we'll be on our way. All right, guys, we're back at Race Only. You guys might recognize Omar. Yeah, legend has been helping me out with this car for some time now. So we're back here, and most of the time when you go for a dyno tune, you kind of go for more power, but in this case, we really want control today. So
correct.
Yes. My goal, and I don't know about your goals, but my goal today is to get kind of just the boost tuned down to a level where we can hold it at 7 pound, 8 pound for my low boost setting, and then have a higher boost setting where we can hold it there at 16 pound or 15 pounds and not worry that it'll spike.
So what are you using for boost control, if you don't mind asking?
We're using a three port solenoid.
Is it eBoost or is it Haltech?
The Haltech one.
Haltech, cool. Yeah.
So awesome. Quick rundown, if you have only watched this video, since the last tune, we've only done the ARTEC manifold and a 60 millimeter gate. That's pretty much it. We're keeping the 98 fuel, and today's all about
seeing how the ARTEC flows and seeing if we can
get some boost control into this. Boost.
Yeah. So yeah, I should also include, we now have a new dyno setup.
Yes, hub dyno.
So I know Omar's been waiting for this for a while. And what do we have now?
So it's a Dynotech 2000 horsepower hub dyno.
Yep.
And I waited 2 years for this thing and it finally came.
Finally.
And it's the best thing. Yeah. Honestly, it completely changes the tuning experience.
Mm.
So very,
I think
very
I've only used the hub dyno twice, and I'd say every time I've witnessed just the repeatability. And you know, even with a roller dyno, you just one click of the strap and it could be a different
thing. I think on a 400 horsepower car, you could go up or down in horsepower by 50 horsepower just on straps.
Mm.
And for me, like, that's cool for a dyno number, but it doesn't give you confidence as a tuner as to whether the changes you're making actually make a difference.
That's right. So this time we'll be on the hub and no longer the rollers. So the reading's going to be a bit different, but definitely we'll be able to see how the boost control is. We've only gotten the opportunity to do one long drive. So that was about 45 minutes sitting in traffic. Everything's okay. I just noticed that the oil drain that we will be replacing is fouling on the rubber boot. And it is quite hot there, so something we're gonna look out for. But otherwise, he's ready.
So we're gonna put the new firmware in there, which lets you use the buttons for the IC7 as inputs.
Oh, cool.
Obviously, whenever you're doing firmware updates, it's always scary that something might go wrong.
Yeah, I'm never game.
you know what? I'd rather do it now.
Yeah.
Since we have the tools and the ability to kind of problem solve. I mean, if you end up doing it later and something goes wrong, you kind of get stuck there spending weeks trying to figure out what little thing changed that changed everything. And as I mean, you saw with your misfire issue, how something so small causes such a big issue. So yeah. we're halfway through now. So there we go.
I also think I might need to go with a Haltech dash because my cluster's just gone off. Literally 2 months ago, just for whatever reason, started reading about 800 RPM higher.
I think you should do the UC10. It looks pretty.
I know, it does, hey.
So we sold a couple of hoods and dashes to a couple of guys in the US, and he sent me a photo. I'll show you shortly, but it looks
UC10
amazing.
And FD. I know Daniel's doing it, but I haven't actually seen one fit yet.
I'll show you a photo. It actually looks like it sits in the right place. Because you know the IC7, actually, I find, especially in the molds that we have, it sits too low, so yeah, you miss out on most of the dash.
Yeah.
One thing I would suggest when you're doing ethanol content is you've got 0 and 65. Maybe that's something I did. But I always put 10% as my minimum because generally you'll find you want to get to the lowest boost setting, not at 0%, but more like 10% ethanol content. Same with the upper end. So we've got the upper end at 65. I don't find much changes after that ethanol content. So whether you're at 65, 75, 85, it seems to be very similar in terms of what boost you can run and things like that.
Yeah.
So we've got that at 16.5, I believe, because that's what it wanted to run.
Yeah.
So we've got a 7-pound spring, I believe.
Now we do.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in 8 pounds as our target. We'll see what it does.
Mm.
Now you've got the spool assist on. So spool assist tends to make the car a bit jumpy on the initial tip-in. But
yeah. Like a partial throttle tip-in?
Yeah, so like say you're bringing the car on boost, it holds the wastegate shut till you reach your target boost level, and that takes to make the car really snappy.
Yeah.
But we can actually tweak that using this setting here. So this is something called an offset. So basically, if our target boost is 8 pounds, it will return the gate to normal position 7 pounds away from the target. So this is very conservative.
Mm.
So we'll leave that as it is for now. We'll probably close that down a bit later.
Earlier in the video, I did mention something about like mid-corner, like a partial throttle, almost felt like it was scavenging, and it had this effect where it unsettled the car. And
yeah,
it makes it really not confidence-inspiring to drive, so.
So there's another thing, and I can't remember if this was something I did or not, but this boost table here's got 100% down the bottom, and then it's got your actual boost duty values.
Yeah.
When you use the spool assist, you don't need to do this.
Okay.
So basically, you just factor in all the GD numbers that are required to make X amount of boost at that level.
Yeah.
And the ECU will know when to close the gate, open the gate, and so on. So I'm just going to put some numbers here to get started and see how close we get.
Cool.
Another good thing to note is MAC valves tend to do nothing below 10% and not much over 90%.
Gotcha.
So never try and tune a MAC valve under 10% or over 90%. They're not actually doing anything. They're either wide open or they're closed. What's the maximum boost you're chasing, you think?
You tell me, Omar.
Well, I mean,
I think we initially, like the last dyno session, we said 15, 16 max.
I think so.
Yep. I hit the boost cut a lot at 18.
Yep.
But it actually went higher than that.
Of course.
I think it was like 22 pounds.
Look, because it'll do that.
Yeah.
Because if you have a boost cut set at 18, even that 200 milliseconds it takes for the cut to effectively, that's correct.
Yeah. What do you think, 16?
Yeah, I think we'll aim for 16. Yeah. This is our boost cut. And basically, if the target boost is 6 pounds, then, you know, boost cut is 9 pounds. So that gives us 3 pounds of overhead. That's probably an okay starting point. The other thing I'll make sure is, and that is 200, so literally 0.2 seconds is how long it'll wait before it cuts out.
Sure.
And it allows 1.5 pounds of hysteresis. So basically that means our actual difference will be like 4 pounds.
Yeah.
So I think that's all acceptable. As long as you've got enough injector, which we do, I don't see that being an issue.
Yeah.
Okay,
so. All people asking me what injectors I'm using.
Ah, yes.
And still using the factory primaries, I think.
Yes.
550s.
Yep.
And the secondaries are 2600s.
Correct. Yeah. Correct.
So far going okay, but I know when we get E85, we might maybe need to increase
E85 primaries. The thing is, right, if you don't do the primary injector, you need to do even more on the secondary. And I mean, the next size up from a 2600 is a 3700.
Mm.
And I'm going to say going from a 550 to a 3700 will probably result in some sort of misfire there'll be some drivability issue there.
I mean, have you seen the new FuelTech injectors?
Well, that's the right. So the smallest one is the 3700. Then they've got a 4800, and obviously they've got bigger ones than that as well. Mm. I haven't tuned it yet, but we've just done a car with 1700 primaries and 4800 secondaries. So we're trying to do that to avoid having to do six injectors. Six injectors to do on FC is actually quite a pain in the ass. So,
I'd never want to find out.
But yeah, we'll find out. I think it should be cool. And you know what? So that's another thing. Rotaries love getting fuel in the secondary runner. So when you prioritize bigger injectors for the secondary runners, you normally see a significant power bump. Like I've seen 5 to 10%, depending on the ratio between primary and secondary. So it's actually a good thing to do it that way as well.
Mm.
But we'll see how we go. I think we're ready to rock, dude. I feel like we've done all our basic checks.
Awesome.
So let's give it a crack and see how we go. So far, still 7 pounds, no boost creek yet, and I think fuel mixture looks like
it's tracking. Where are you up to at the RPM?
Sorry?
Where are you up to with the RPM?
I'll answer that shortly. I believe 5,500.
Oh, that's not bad.
Yeah.
It would have started spiking by now.
You know, I'll turn this around. So that white line there is our boost curve, and as you can see, that's as flat as it comes. So
that's good.
Looks really good. Very happy with what we have so far.
So you've done the firmware update?
Yes.
And has that affected the fuel mixtures?
I'm just about to lay it over. Yeah, so you can see how far away we are from target.
Yeah.
So I'll have to adjust our map to make that. But yeah, this is something I've seen going from 310 to 311. For whatever reason, we always see a much richer fuel mixture on the boost. But I mean, like, rich is better than lean, so I'll take it.
Yeah, good.
Boost is still holding. That was 7,200.
That's good. I don't remember what we've read this to.
I think this engine's going to want to go at least 8,000.
Yeah, I think last time was 8.
Oh, look at this. We're actually getting a bit of a boost drop. Not a huge amount, so we're down at 6 pounds by the red line.
Yeah, cool.
That explains why the fuel mixture did what it did.
Yeah.
So based on that, I'm going to say the 50 would suffice on this.
Yeah.
I don't think
this anyway.
Yeah. So the fact that we're trying to run 7 pounds and it's actually dropping in boost, that tells me that this wastegate definitely outflowing the turbo. Yeah. There's no qualms there.
I'm okay with that, actually.
So you just make up for it in boost control.
Yeah. I got to ask, have you tuned one on the 50 mil gate yet on the ARTEC?
No, and that'll be Faiz's car.
It's on the hoist.
Yeah. So that's literally waiting on fabricating.
Faiz He's keen.
He's definitely psyched.
I guess then only then will you truly know if it's worth the 60.
Correct. And Faiz's car's got an 8374 and they're usually very susceptible to overboost.
Okay.
So that'll be a real test as to whether they can hold. A little trick I do when I'm tuning to try and figure out why my AFO curve may be looking a little lumpy or bumpy, I look at something called base fuel tuning. So this is this white line here. And it just basically tells me what the shape of the fuel curve is. And you can kind of see as this kind of really starts to climb aggressively, you see in the wideband mixture, it starts to go rich.
Mm.
So this just means that my fuel curve shape is not right. And it's not what the engine wants. Still dropped off, just not as much.
Yeah.
So we're at 6.5 pounds up there, which is pretty impressive at 320 horsepower at that boost.
I know.
Look, I will
say 6.5 pound.
It's on the leaner side, so once we put some fuel in there, that's going to come down a bit. But still impressive.
Mm.
And look, I will say the O2 sensor is working because whatever changes I make, the shape is changing.
Yeah.
It just seems like the number is richer.
In case you've missed it, it looks like we have a slightly different reading on the wide band on the car compared to the one on the dyno.
Yes.
But we're just tuning around the one on the dyno because we think it's more accurate.
I believe so, yes.
But at least it doesn't look like it's malfunctioning, it's just reading slightly different.
Yeah. I think we have like 0.3 to 0.4 offset between the dyno and the ECU, which is not too bad.
Yeah, negligible.
I mean, considering the length of the pipe and whatnot, you do get some variance, but I feel like this is more than I normally see.
And we tend to keep it a bit rich as well.
Yes.
Especially when this car does some track work.
Most definitely.
Yeah. Being a hub dyno now, not the roller, and just see how much more consistent the lines are. And we don't have to make any adjustment to the way the car's strapped. And then the only thing we're noticing up here is what we're changing on the computer, so that's good. 347 horsepower, and that is on 8.5 pound of boost. So Omar's been just doing some tuning on the computer because he's found that whatever the setup has changed, whatever we've changed, the engine seems to be wanting a bit more fuel.
Specifically up top, so over 7,000. Yeah, over 7,000. So 7 to 8,000, I've got an extra 2% of fuel that it didn't want before.
Mm.
And to be honest, looking at the curve compared to what we saw on the other dyno, I mean, the power's not rolling over anymore up top like it did before.
Yeah.
So to me, both, you know, the fact that it wants more fuel and that it shows more top end, shows that you've done something to make it more efficient up top.
In short, we're making more power.
We're definitely making more power. Definitely making more power.
Yeah.
So
we did have those trigger sync errors before.
Yes, so that could have been
be contributing to that.
Most definitely. I figure that's the kind of control you might want.
Yeah.
And I mean, if I go up by two, if you go up by one, we should be pretty on the money. All right, let's do another one. I think that's pretty good.
Yeah, that's really good.
That's
Omar's doing calculus.
Yeah.
Look at those graphs.
It's amazing. Once you get the base right, you just put the boost in and ECU does the rest.
No, that's good. And we shouldn't mention it's a warm day too.
Yeah, and those last five runs were back to back.
Yeah, that's right. Back to back.
So very happy with that. So that last run was 14.3 pounds.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think our base duty table is pretty on the money.
Yep.
Every 2 pounds has given us 2 pounds.
Yep.
I think I'm pretty happy with it.
Would you want to do one more?
I don't mind.
All right, we're going for one more. The moon tune, as some call it. And I was more keen for this. So yeah, let's see if it keeps going up.
About the boost controller.
Yeah.
Now we're having to do larger increments to get more boost.
It's closer to the limit.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, man. I actually hit the rev limiter on that run.
Yeah,
that
I saw. Was enough. What was the rev limiter?
8,500.
85, yeah, cool.
So, and it's kind of still climbing.
It is, in a small amount. But yeah, you can see how repeatable this is. You can also see how much control we have over the power.
So we were talking about boost by Gi. So this is the table that we'll be using. So always just be mindful of the ethanol content. Not that we're using it yet, but if you make changes in this table, it won't reflect anything. It won't change anything, obviously.
Yep.
So we're working in the 10% or less. And I'll just
pretty much leave it at 10% until we add 85.
Correct. Yeah. So I'm going to say first gear, you probably want as little boost as possible. I'm just at a guess, right?
Yep.
Second gear, I'd say you could probably do, I would say at least 12. And I would say for your first track session, these top three gears, I would do 14 as your first outing. And I would add boost to these areas once you've got some track data, if you like.
Yeah.
And look, you can add the boost in different areas. So like Rahul, he likes to not put too much in the middle here because it tends to unsettle the car.
Mm.
And he tends to feed most of his boost in the 6, 7, 8,000 range.
Yep.
One thing we did on his, because his car runs out of injector at the 25-pound setting, we have a 9,000 RPM row, and we basically turn the boost down as the RPM goes there. Because he likes to stretch his car to like 9,500 in some of the gears so that he doesn't have to go to the next
gear. That's right.
Which, yeah. You could do the same.
Yeah.
I probably wouldn't do it on pump fuel. You find the EGTs get really hot.
I found that's with this RPM. Car, I haven't needed to. Maybe with the gearing.
Yeah.
I think it's different to Rahul's, but with the gearing, I haven't needed
to. It is. So, but yeah, man, look, it's so easy. Honestly, like, just hit the boost number you want, and it's going to
that's
do
right.
It.
And it's something we really need either someone to tinker with this at the track. It's no point doing it here.
No.
Because the cars, for every circuit, it's going to be a bit different.
Most definitely. The neutral boost setting, by the way, doesn't really make a difference. Only makes a difference if you're going to use a two-step.
Yeah.
So I'll put down 8 pounds in case 16. You get carried away.
All right.
But look, that's pretty much it, dude. Yeah.
So overall, how are you finding? I mean, this is your first car with the ARTEC. How are you finding it?
Pretty impressed.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think I'm pretty impressed.
Yeah, I mean, the power's there and the control is just...
is excellent.
Finite. Very good.
I'm very interested to see how we go with the other one with the 50 mil, only because that's a bolt-on rather than a weld-on option.
Yep.
And it does give you more room on the downpipe.
Yeah, definitely.
But so far, I'm very impressed.
Yeah. And one day when that happens, we'll report back.
Yeah. That's it. Hopefully
guys, want to thank Omar always for helping me with this car.
No worries.
It started off so rough, and we built it into a nice beast.
It looks amazing. It looks amazing.
Yeah.
So.
And I'm really hoping to get out to the track soon.
Yeah.
So yeah, thanks for watching, guys. We just hit 10,000 subs today.
Yeah.
So pretty excited.
Awesome.
Make sure if you like the video, make sure you like it, share it, and please subscribe. And guys, thank you so much for watching, and thanks to Omar again from Race Only.
No worries.
See you guys in the next video.